I'm old enough to remember the Unabomber, Ted Kaczynski sending his manifesto and getting it published in the New York Times, the Washington Post, the fear with that. Generations grew up dealing with the wars and the poverty and the famines and the revolutions caused by the Communist Manifesto, right? We hear that word and it conjures up these negative connotations, but a manifesto does not have to be a negative thing. All it is a simple public declaration of the intents, the beliefs, the policies of whoever it is that's sharing. And I say all this because a manifesto is one of the words that was used to describe Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. This is his public declaration of his policies, his intents, what he believes. You see, we have been going through this series on Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 through 12, the Beatitudes. We've been talking kind of verse by verse through this on what they mean, but to show you the larger context, I think is important. It's important to see this is early on in Jesus' ministry. Jesus has been traveling around. He's turned water into wine. He has healed the blind. He has healed those who are sick and lame. He's begun to teach in the synagogues. He's saying, repent, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Repent, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. But when he climbs up onto that mountainside, and as the crowds have gathered around him, Jesus is about to give his manifesto. What is it that he is all about? The zealots within Israel were hoping that Jesus, of course, would come out and denounce Rome and say, rise up, people of Israel. Get these pagan, godless Romans out of the Holy Land. The Pharisees, they hoped that Jesus would come like the prophet Elijah and talk about how wicked and sinful Israel was for not following the law like the Pharisees followed the law. The Sadducees hoped that Jesus would stand up and tell people to calm down, that it's not so bad, to get along, that God is working even now. You don't have to freak out about these Romans. But Jesus stands up and he doesn't talk about politics. He doesn't talk about Rome. He talks about what a blessed life looks like. And he opens his mouth and he taught them, saying, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. And blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. He says, blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. Today, if you're taking notes, I want to encourage you to write down this phrase. Pull out your phones, pull out your notebooks, write down the kingdom of God. This is what Jesus is giving his manifesto of. This is a manifesto of the kingdom of God. He says in verse 1, he calls it the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Kingdom of God and kingdom of heaven are interchangeable. But what I want you to see is that he's really talking about two different things in these 12 verses. He's talking about the kingdom of God. How is it that I get there? How can I get into the kingdom of God? And how is it that I live there? How do I live within the kingdom of God? It's both pieces. How do I get there? He addresses this in the first four Beatitudes. He says that if you want to see the kingdom of God, If you want to see the kingdom of heaven, then you have to be poor in spirit. I have to let go of my self-righteousness. I have to recognize my sinfulness. And as a result of that recognition, I mourn over that sin. And that mourning leads me to a repentance. I turn away from that sin. And as I turn from that sin, I begin to see God for who he is. And I begin to see myself for who I am. And it causes me to be meek. And I'm humbled in God's presence. Humbled enough that I ask that same God, God, save me. I know I'm unable to save myself. God, save me. And Jesus says, for those who are hungry and thirsty for righteousness, remember, righteousness simply means a right relationship between you and God. For those of who have walked that path, poor in spirit, mourning over our sin, crying out to God in our meekness and hungry and thirsty for that right relationship, the kingdom of heaven is ours. That's how you enter in. And for all of you here today, this is still how we enter into the kingdom of God. Not based on anything that we have done, but based on what Jesus has done on our behalf. You see, it is our sins that separate us from God. But God loved the world so much, he sent his only son, Jesus. And Jesus took upon himself the punishment that my sins deserved. And now, even today, where you sit, if you will call out, if you will place your faith and your trust in God, Jesus Christ, his sacrifice to save you, you will be saved. That's how you get there. But the next four Beatitudes have to deal with how I live in a kingdom like that. And I think that the order of that is very intentional, by the way. The first four deal with the inner attitudes of someone who is going to get into the kingdom. The next four deal with a manifestation, the outward expression of what God has done inside of us. But so often we get those two things flipped. You see, we think that what God is looking for is the outward expression. God wants us to do something, be something. But the truth is, God is not simply concerned with our right actions. He wants our right actions to come out of our right heart, a right place. If you just read a couple of passages with me in Hosea chapter 6, verse 6, God says that I desire steadfast love and not sacrifice, the knowledge of God rather than burnt offerings. Look at Psalm chapter 51, verses 16 and 17. For you will not delight in sacrifice, or I would give it. You would not be pleased with a burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. God is not simply interested in correct behavior. God wants our motivations to be right. He wants our heart. He doesn't just want the sacrifice. He says, I don't care about the sacrifice. I care about you. I care about your heart and about your soul. When I was in college, I woke up one morning and I was not feeling very good. I did what I normally do when I don't feel very well. I drank a bunch of water. I ate good food. I tried to get some extra rest, but the next day I woke up and I felt really not good. I had a fever. I had some weird swelling in my leg. And so I started to treat those symptoms. I took a bunch of painkillers. I drank a bunch of water. I got extra rest. I figured this would just get better. I'm going to just treat the symptoms. Well, the next day I woke up and I was like, really, really sick. My leg was all swollen and the swelling and redness was spreading. I had a fever. I was nauseous. And so I took a bunch of medicine. I drank a lot of water. And I had a big flag football game. So I wrapped up my leg with an ACE bandage that I bought from a pharmacy. And I went and tried to play. And I'm telling you, I did not feel well. Well, it wasn't but a day or two later that I ended up in the hospital. I had been, that weird swelling on my leg, I had been bitten by a spider, apparently. It had gotten infected with an antibiotic-resistant MRSA staph infection. And although I had been treating symptom after symptom, they said that if I had waited much longer to go to the hospital, I would have been terminally sick. I would have died. And so the doctors did what I didn't. They said, I don't care about the symptoms. We're going to treat the problem. And I went and I got surgery and they cleaned out this infection and they pumped my body filled with these super strong antibiotics. And before long, because they had dealt with the actual issue, the symptoms began to subside. So often in our own lives, we come to church or we talk to God because of a symptom. Maybe it's a relationship that's struggling or a marriage that's falling apart. Maybe it's an addiction that suddenly feels outside of your control. Maybe it's a fear or an anxiety about life and you're nervous and you're not sure what to do. And you come to church and you just want someone to deal with your symptoms. But what God wants to deal with is the root issue, the problem. It's the heart. And that's what these Beatitudes are communicating. We can't simply jump to the last four before we deal with the first four. And I wanted to be very clear about that this morning, because the next four are dealing with manifestations of a heart that's been fixed by God. And in verse 7, what Jesus says in Matthew 5:7 is, blessed are the what? Let me hear you say it. Merciful. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. So here's the question for today. What is mercy? What is mercy? The first thing that I want to talk about just briefly is the way that that statement is constructed. It makes it sound like your salvation is conditional upon you expressing mercy to someone. But what we know from Jesus' other teachings, from the rest of the epistles, is that there is nothing that I could do that would earn my salvation. There is no amount of good works that I can that I could do that earn God's favor. God doesn't look at me when I die and I stand before him and open up his book and say, oh, well, there was 22 acts of mercy that he performed, and so I will, in payment for your mercy, I will give you 22% mercy. That's not how God does that. What this is saying, first of all, it is not a condition for our salvation. What Jesus is communicating is that anyone who has received the mercy of God, you've walked that path, poor in spirit, mourning over sin, meek, hungry and thirsty for righteousness, you've turned to Jesus. You, if you have truly received mercy from God, you will be merciful. This is a manifestation. Now, what mercy is, I think we instinctively believe we understand, but it's not so simple. A simple study of the history shows that the Romans, which remember, Jesus is speaking in a time where the Romans are ruling over Israel. The Romans did not view mercy as some sort of good thing. They actually thought that mercy and justice were opposites. Roman culture thought that mercy was weakness. Justice was the highest virtue. One of their philosophers is famous to have said that mercy is a disease of the soul. That's how the Romans viewed mercy. The Jewish rabbis viewed mercy as more transactional in nature. One of the famous rabbis, Gamaliel, he wrote this, that whenever thou hast mercy on someone, God will have mercy on thee. And if thou hast not mercy, then God will not have mercy on thee. This is transactional. This is salvation by works. If you have mercy, God will have mercy. If you don't have mercy, God won't have mercy. I think in our culture, many people view mercy in sort of a humanistic view. We have a high view of human nature. If only someone would be merciful, then another will be merciful in return. It's sort of one of these things. If only I am merciful to this person, well, they'll be merciful to me, and then they'll be merciful to another person. And before we know it, everyone's holding hands and singing "We Are the World" together. But just look at the state of the world. Is that true? That's not human nature. Jesus was the most merciful person that ever lived, and what did he receive? A cross. I think for most of us, our mercy operates on emotion and instinct. And so maybe you're sitting there watching TV and a commercial comes on. And you see these little dogs. And they're so neglected and they've been beaten. And before you know it, the tears are running down your face, and you know, you just know that if that dog had a wallet and it saw you sitting beside a dusty road on some barbed wire, that it would help you out. And you open up your wallet and you make the phone call. Why? Because you felt something. Is that a biblical view of mercy? I think that mercy, from a biblical point of view, is compassion in action. If you're looking for a simple definition, it's just that. Mercy is compassion in action. Anytime that you see mercy in Scripture, it is accompanied by an action. James, the brother of Jesus, in James chapter 2, verse 15, he says this: if a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of you says to them, "Go in peace, be warm and filled," without giving them the things needed for their body, what good is that? Mercy is not a simple emotion. It's not an intention. It's not sporadic. It's not spontaneous. It's not driven by emotion. True mercy is compassion in action. Now, you need to understand this one thing about compassion. Compassion should be linked to your sanctification. Now, I know that that's a big word, sanctification, but if you remember, sanctification is me being set apart. It is God doing his work to make me look more like Jesus. As I draw closer and closer to Jesus by reading his word, studying his word, listening to his word, as I begin to see people the way that Jesus sees them, as I begin to love the things that Jesus loves and hate the things that Jesus hates, I will begin to have compassion on those who have compassion that Jesus has compassion on. This is a part of our sanctification. When we were talking in Colossians back in July, back in Colossians chapter 3, it says, as a result of the word of God dwelling within you, you will have a compassionate heart. That's what that scripture says. In essence, the people of God are meant not to be takers, but givers. We're supposed to love the things that God loves, but it's not enough to have a feeling of compassion. That compassion needs to have action. We need to have compassion in action. Now, I read a quote this week. It was such a simple quote. I found it profound, but maybe you won't. It just says that good intentions never once put an onion in the soup. And yet I think so often we are so focused on our intentions. Well, I meant to, but I wanted to, but I... True biblical mercy puts the onion in the soup. It makes a difference. It's why I was so very proud of our church this past week in Four Grove City Week. You, all of you who chose to serve this week, to serve our city, to show them the love of Jesus Christ in practical ways, you were ambassadors for Christ. You took the mercy that God has shown to you and you put it into action. And I could not have been more proud of our church. This is the type of church we want to be, merciful. Now, there's a couple of different ways that we can show mercy and that we should show mercy. I want us to look at the first being physical mercy. Turn with me, or you can see it on the screen here, to Matthew chapter 25. Jesus gives us a window into the end of time. And he tells us this story in verses 31 through 40. Here's what he says: when the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, he'll sit on his glorious throne. And before him will be gathered all the nations. He will separate people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He'll place the sheep on his right, but the goats on the left. And then the king will say to those on his right, come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you before the foundation of the world. Now listen to physical mercy. For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty, you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me. And then the righteous will answer him, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? When did we see you a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? And when did we see you sick or in prison and visit you? And the king will answer them and say, truly I say to you, as you did it to one of the least of these, my brothers, you did it to me. In this passage, Jesus describes physical mercy. And he says that when we offer physical mercy, things like food to the hungry, drink to the thirsty, clothes to those who need them, then we do that not just for his children, the people that God has created and loves, but we do that for him. That's an act of physical mercy. We are meant to be the hands and feet of Christ in true, practical ways. And I know that for many of us, that starts with just being faithful to give. To give back a portion of what we earn and make to the Lord, to the church. And I want you to know that when you give here at Covenant Church, you're investing in life change. We support other ministries that directly feed the hungry, that help at crisis pregnancy centers, that provide dental care for people that are struggling. We support ministries that go when there's a natural disaster and provide relief and help and food for those who are hurting. When you give, you participate in that physical mercy. And here's the part that I love about it. When we allow our compassion to turn into action, when we actually take a step, what happens is we begin to better understand the mercy that we've received from God. It helps us to better understand just what God has done for us. It causes me to worship. It draws me closer. It gives me a better appreciation for my Savior. We have been blessed, haven't we, church? Has God blessed you? And yet we find ourselves building sheds to fill up with the stuff that doesn't fit in our third car garages. When there are people around us who are hurting, who are hungry, who need help, the Church of Jesus Christ is meant to see them, to notice them, to love them, and to take action. Why? That's because what God did for me. I show mercy because I've been shown mercy. The second way that we should be showing mercy is through emotional mercy. And I know that this is something that you may never have thought about, but this is an important part of the Christian life as well. John chapter 8, verse 3 through 11. This is a passage that's very familiar to many of us. A woman caught in adultery. The scribes and Pharisees brought a woman who had been caught in adultery. And placing her in the midst, they said to him, they're talking to Jesus, teacher, this woman has been caught in the act of adultery. Now in the law of Moses, it's commanded to us to stone such women. What do you say? This they said to test him, that they might have some charge to bring against him. Jesus bent down and he wrote with his finger on the ground. And as they continued to ask him, he stood up and he said, "Let him who is without sin among you be the first to throw a stone at her." And then once more he bent down and he wrote on the ground. But when they heard it, they went away, one by one, beginning with the older ones. And Jesus was left alone with the woman standing before him. And here is this moment of emotional mercy. Jesus stood up and said to her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" She said, "No one, Lord." And then Jesus said, "Neither do I condemn you. Go. From now on, sin no more." Emotional mercy goes against our human nature. It is mercy for me, justice for you. And we learn that at a young age. I'm always reminded about it at Halloween. Our kids come home with these bulging bags filled with candy, right? More candy than they'll eat in the entire year. And yet, they want to steal the candy from each other's bags. And if one sibling gets caught stealing candy, it's just one piece. It's not a big deal. They have a ton of it. But if they get stolen from, send them to Azkaban. Let the Dementors deal with them. Justice. This should not be the case. Christians, we should have short memories for the wrongs that have been done to us. If there is repentance that has taken place, there needs to be forgiveness that happens in our hearts. And I know what that means, by the way. I know that if someone truly hurts you, they wrong you, and they ask for forgiveness and they repent of that, and you forgive them from your heart, they'll never get the justice that they deserve for the wrong that they did to you. They'll never get it. But we have to remember, we don't get it either. God has showed us justice, but he showed it by placing it upon his son, Jesus. We got mercy. I've heard it said that out of all the animals in the animal kingdom, an elephant has the longest memory. Like, they can remember other elephants that they met 30 years ago. It's crazy. But I wonder, have those same scientists studied the wife of the husband who forgot to take out the trash that one time 9 years ago, and she had to go out into the snow and pull the bins? That's a long memory. Have they studied the husband that never forgot when she backed into the garage door and left a dent? She hasn't let him forget. He has not let her forget about that. And if someone has repented, we need to show them mercy. And what that means is you don't bring it up again. You don't keep bringing it up. You don't hold them hostage for the past mistake. And I'm not just saying that you stick your hand back in the mouth of a dog that bit you the next day, okay? I'm not saying you just go back and get kicked again and again and again. That's not what I'm saying. But if there is true and genuine repentance, we need to deal with our own unforgiveness. We need to show emotional mercy. The last one is one that we don't have a lot of time for, but it's spiritual mercy. This is something that we cannot give to someone else. Jesus tells this parable in Matthew chapter 18. He tells a parable about two servants. One owes this debt that's the equivalent of millions of dollars. And the king comes and he says, "Hey, your debt is due." And the servant falls to his knees and says, "I cannot pay. I beg you to forgive me. Show me mercy." And the king shows mercy and clears this entire debt that this servant could never pay for. And that servant climbs up off of their knees and they walk out of the presence of the king and they walk down into the servants' quarters and they find this other servant that owes him like $20. And they say, hey, I need that $20. And this other servant falls to their knees and begs and says, I can't pay you now, but I will pay you. I promise you. Please show me mercy. And that servant looks at the other one and says, go to jail until you can pay this debt. The king finds out what this other servant did, the one whose debt he had lavishly forgiven, and he is not happy. And this is meant to be a picture of the sin debt that we owe to God, a debt that we could never pay, a debt that has only been taken care of because of God's love for us and his mercy that he showed to us. We are meant to show the same type of mercy that we have received. If you are a part of the kingdom of God, you cannot forgive sins. You cannot show spiritual mercy, but you can point to the one who does, Jesus Christ. May his name be glorified. He has shown me mercy, and now I can show that same mercy. My friends, we are a people who have received the mercy of God, aren't we? And now we have an opportunity every day to meet the needs of others. It's a privilege, by the way, to give, to serve. We have an opportunity to alleviate the guilt and the shame by showing people emotional mercy, forgiving from our heart, allowing God to deal with the consequences. And we have the blessed, amazing opportunity of pointing people to spiritual mercy, which can only be found in a relationship with Jesus Christ. Blessed are the merciful. I want to end today by talking about something and doing something I don't ever do, which is I want to talk about politics. And I want to just talk to you guys from the heart, if that's okay. Because in a couple of days, there's an amendment to our Constitution that's on the ballot. And you're probably like me. You're sick of all the commercials and all the literature and all the people knocking on your doors and the door hangers. But I think that I feel so strongly about talking to you guys about this is because I don't see this as a left-right issue. I don't see this as a Democrat-Republican issue. I'm not dealing with that stuff. I see this as an issue of whether we're going to accept God's wisdom about this world or the world's wisdom about this world. You see, this constitutional amendment will drastically and dramatically expand abortion access here in our state. It will remove protections that exist for unborn children. And in addition to that, it will scale back parental rights to know what's going on with their minor children when it comes to reproductive issues and maybe even beyond that. Now, I know that you've probably seen commercials that frame the issue very differently than that. But as usual, the devil is in the details, isn't it? And when I read this, I see an amendment that is written so intentionally vague as to allow for abortion to take place at almost any time during a pregnancy for almost any reason that a person could come up with. I see the same when it comes to a parent's rights to know what's going on with their minor children. Kids that aren't young enough to vote, kids that aren't young enough to buy a pack of cigarettes, will now be able to make a decision, a life-changing decision about their own child and potentially beyond that with their own health without a parent's knowledge or consent. More than that, here's what I see. I see the world's wisdom pitted against God's wisdom. The world says that an unborn child is an inconvenience. And God says that that is a precious life that I love and I created. God says, I know their name. I know how many hairs are on their head. I know what their laugh's gonna sound like. I know what their stupid dance moves are gonna look like when they're teenagers. I know them. I love them. God is the author of life. He creates life. He sustains life. He loves life. And the world says that if it's inconvenient, kill it. God says, love it. It's a blessing. Cherish it. And for us as a church, we have a chance to show compassion in action, not just for unborn children, but for mothers who are struggling and for babies after birth. This is who we should be. And although it's not something I do often, I want you to strongly consider whether this amendment, which would enshrine the right to abortion, is what God would want. I'm voting no, and I'd encourage you to as well. Would you guys pray with me? Lord, you know that I hate talking about politics and that my heart is truly to be, God, obedient to you. Lord, I want the things that you love to be the things that we love as a church. And God, I truly believe that you love each and every one of your children, made in your image, precious in your sight. And I think that we as a church should want to protect them. Not just them, but their mothers who maybe weren't ready to be pregnant or maybe who are worried about it, Lord. May we step up in true and tangible ways as we have in the past, Lord, but even more so in the future. May the Church of Jesus Christ be known as a place of mercy and compassion in action for those who need it. God, I love you and I thank you for your word. And I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak into the life of this church body that I love, my friends, my brothers and sisters in Christ. Thank you for each and every person who is here. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.